Right, good evening everybody. All of you are welcome for the CFR seminar series for 2019 December. Right, this is the last chance to pass this subject, because from the next syllabus onward, that next year onward, you have a new subject, advanced financial reporting with the high percentage of governance also, because the entire syllabus has been changed. Therefore, in the next year onward, you have financial reporting plus governance also in the syllabus. Therefore, this time you can try to pass the subject, because otherwise we have to add additional parts to our syllabus, right? Okay, then other important point, this is the first financial year we are going to apply SLFRS 16, right? And as we discussed last day, last exam, I told you the last exam can be tested for IFRS 9 and 15, and it was tested, but it was tested the basics. Therefore, this time I think you have three questions. The last question, consolidation, ratio analysis and ethics will cover. First and second questions will cover the most of the accounting standards. Both two questions, question number 1 and 2, I think you may have questions from SLFRS 9, 15 and 16. Therefore, I am going to cover the all the theoretical and practical areas of SLFRS 9, 15 and 16 this time. Thereafter, we can add additional standard based on the time availability, right? Okay, today we can start with SLFRS 16, leasing, right? This is the very first time. I'm also going to lecture this standard for CFR students, right? Therefore, I have make a presentation by summarizing the entire standards for your convenience. The most important in this standard, especially not this, IFRS 9, IFRS 15 and IFRS 16, all the three standards, before apply this standard, you have to understand for which area this standard can be applied. That is very important, right? For all the transactions, if it is lease, for all the leasing transactions, you cannot apply this standard. If it is a financial asset, you cannot apply for all the financial assets. If it is revenue from contract with customer, some contract excluded from this standard. Therefore, all these three standard, most important point, for which type of transaction you can apply this standard, right? Therefore, this is the most important part of this standard. Specially focus the paragraph numbers I have given you. If you have the standard book, better to turn that paragraph number, right? This paragraph 9 explain for which type of transaction you can apply this standard. This is the most important paragraph of this standard. I am telling again, this is the most important paragraph of this standard. If any leasing transaction not satisfy the requirement of paragraph 9, you cannot apply this standard. You have to say, no, we can't apply this. Because in your paper, most of the questions are in advisory type questions. You have to advise the management or board. Therefore, to advise about the application of SLFRS 16 depend on the paragraph 9. Clear? The important areas of the paragraph 9 I have summarized, just like an engine of a vehicle, to perform all the wheels, we need to consider more important two points. To take any leasing agreement in between lessor and lessee, right, can be taken under this standard, SLFRS 16, if that agreement identified special asset and that user has the control of use, right? Right to control the use of identified asset. Within the agreement, there should be an asset. Now, leasing agreement, I'm talking about the leasing agreement. To take leasing agreement under this standard, within the standard as well as in the practice, there should be an asset. And the lessee should have control over the use, not the right. Over the use, they should have the control. That's the first requirement. second requirement for a period of time in exchange of consideration. For the use of that asset, there should be a consideration will flow from the lessee to lessor, from buyer to seller. There should be a flow of consideration over period, and there should be an asset, identified, specified asset. In the agreement of lease, if there is no identified asset or consideration, it is not come under the scope of SLFRS 16. That is a very important point in this standard. It is paragraph 9. Clear? I am not going to show the standard again, because you can easily read and understand the paragraph 9. To take any leasing agreement under the scope of SLFRS 16, within the agreement there should be an identified asset, and there should be an exchange of consideration for a period of time. Clear? Let's take an example how to apply these technical points in practice. This is the example. This is an ACCA question tested. Let's see. Blackcart has outsourced its waste collection to a private sector provider called Waste and Company, and pays an annual amount to Waste and Company for its service. Understand the transaction. This entity outsources the disposal process of waste. Say you are the municipal council, Colombo Municipal Council, Blackcart say. Assume that Blackcart means Colombo Municipal Council. Now they have a huge problem these days about the waste. Right? They want to remove waste from Colombo City. They will outsource this removal process to Abans. Say Abans doing that type of business, right? For an example. Assume like this, Colombo Municipal Council outsource removing of waste to the Abans, Abans Environment. For an example, right? Not for promoting this, right? Okay. Now, Abans agreed to remove all waste from the Colombo City with the Municipal Council. Waste and Company, assume it is Abans Environment, right? Waste and Company purchases the vehicles. Now they entered into an agreement with Colombo Municipal Council to remove, to transport waste from Colombo City to any other place, right? They have purchases vehicles and uses them exclusively for Blackcart waste collection. Say as Abans has purchased, assume 10 vehicles. Why they have purchased these 10 vehicles? To do this business, exclusively for this business. That Waste and Company purchases vehicles. Then the vehicles are printed with the Blackcart local government organization name and the colors. Assume Abans purchases 10 vehicles, and they have fixed the stickers Colombo Municipal Council waste disposing process. Likewise, they have printed those logos and everything on these vehicles. Blackcart can use the vehicles, and the vehicles are used for waste collection for nearly all of the assets life. Now, the waste company purchases this vehicle only for this process, and they are expecting to use all asset over the lifetime only for this process. They are not going to rent those vehicles for any other purpose. If a vehicle breaks down or no longer must functions, Waste and Company provide a replacement vehicle fitted with the same waste disposal containers and equipment and painted with local government organization and name colors. Is that clear? Now look at the situation. It's just agreement, right? Outsourcing. Outsourcing waste disposal process. But the other company purchased separate vehicle fleets, right? Then printed, fixed the logos and everything, and they are going to use those vehicle only for this agreement. Once they fix the colors and the logos and the name, they cannot use for any other purpose. They will use all these vehicles for this job. This issue is now the lease. The issue here is whether the arrangement with the private sector provider, Waste and Company, is or contain a lease, even if it does not take legal form of a lease. Now, agreement is not a leasing agreement. Outsourcing agreement. clear? But that other party purchases vehicle, printed logos, colors, everything, and exclusively use him for our job to remove our paste. Now, our question, is this come under the SLFRS 16 leasing? The answer is yes. Simple answer is yes. Why? There is a series of payments. And there is an identified asset. That asset will be used only for this job. We have the identified asset there. Right? The purchase, sorry, payments of considerations over period. Therefore, that means that black card can be the lessee, those who are getting the service, and the Western company can be the lessor, those who rented their vehicle to them. Is it clear? But it is just outsource agreement. Now it no need to become a lease agreement. See whether there is identified asset in the agreement and the consideration paying over period. Then it's a lease. It's come under the lease standard. Look at the questions you have to ask from yourself. Is there any identifiable asset? First question you have to ask. When you are evaluating an agreement to see whether it's come under SLFRS 16 or not, read the agreement, then ask a question from you. Is there is an identifiable asset? Does the customer have the right to obtain substantially all the economic benefit from the use of the asset throughout the period of use? Does that black card use all the asset for their purpose? Who has the right to direct how and for what purpose the asset is used? See, who has the right to use the asset? Who has the control over the asset? Clear? Third party purchase vehicle, but fix the logos, colors and everything and the name. Now who has the control over the asset? Black card has the control. Clear? And the next question, does the customer here right to operate the asset throughout the period of use, with the supplier having the right to change those operating instructions? Let's see the answers. Number one, is the identified asset? The vans are an identifiable asset. Although Western company can substitute another vehicle if one of the existing vehicle needs repairing or no longer works, this substitution right not substantive because of the significant cost involving in fitting out the vehicle for use by black card. Even though they replace, they need to fix the color name and everything and replace the asset. Therefore, there is identified. Is an identified asset. Two, black card can use vehicle and use them exclusively for waste collection. For nearly all their life, they have mentioned throughout the useful lifetime, they will use those assets to collect the waste. It therefore has a right to obtain substantially all the economic benefit from the use of the asset. Black card receive all the economic benefit from the asset because asset will be used only for waste disposal. Black card controls vehicles since it stipulates how they are painted and ostensibly owns them because they must be painted with black card name. It therefore has the right to direct how and for what purpose asset is used. That black card advise them, print our name, print our logo, use our color. Therefore, black card has the control to use. Finally, as indicated about two, black card has right to operate asset throughout their period of use. Therefore, our conclusion, the arrangement is a lease and it's come under the SLFRS 60. But it is not a lease agreement, right? According to the characteristic explained in the paragraph 9 of the standard, it's a transaction should be accounted under SLFRS 60. That's how you have to apply this standard. The first thing you need to know, whether we can apply SLFRS 16 or not. The first question for any question. You have to ask a question from yourself, whether I can apply SLFRS 16 or not for this transaction. To apply, there should be identified asset and the lessor should have control over the use of that asset, right? And there should be a consideration over period, payment process. Clear? That is the application of this standard I have the standard also, I will show you. This is SLFRX 16, paragraph 9. At inception of a contract, an entity shall assess whether the contract is or contains a lease. A contract is or contains a lease if the contract conveys the right to control the use of an identified asset for a period of time in exchange for consideration. Is that clear? Therefore, what you need to do? Highlight these points. Then what you need to do? Take these 5 questions here. See whether these, 4 questions satisfy. These 4 questions raised based on that paragraph 9. Is there any identified asset in the agreement? Whether they have the control? Are they getting a consideration? How they are going to use it? Is that clear? Very simple. Black cut requirement will satisfy by the other party by printing the vehicle, printing their names and everything. Therefore, you can see they have the control and they are getting the benefits over the lifetime of the assets. Therefore, even though this is outsource agreement, it will be account under the SLFRS 60. Is that clear? That's the first point. And I want to tell an important point to you. While you listening to me, assume this is the very first time you are learning leasing. I know you have many points in your head about LK70, but I don't know there was LK70. Therefore, right click and permanently delete your memories in LK670. With that, I cannot fill your mind with the techniques of SLFRS 16. Because if you have the memories of LK 17 in your mind, whatever the things I am explaining, you are accepting after fighting with the existing knowledge. Don't allow your existing knowledge to fight with the technical points of 16. If so, you are not getting, you won't be able to understand this standard. Assume this is the very first time I am learning leasing. Right? Now, I think you understood how to apply this standard. That means whether we can apply this standard or not. That's the paragraph 9. Is that clear? Right. Then the big job of this standard, how to apply. Right. Basically, we know we have to account for lessee, the person who buy the asset. We have to account for lessor, person who sell the asset. And we have to account for sale and leaseback transaction. These are the main 3 areas covered by this standard: accounting for lessee, accounting for lessor, and sale and leaseback. This is that entire summary. This is the entire summary of this standard. What you need to do, don't worry, don't waste your time to write it down, because you can have the video tomorrow evening, right? Then you can take the video and note it down. My first advice: take this into your first page of the standard book, not the standard book, SLFRS 16. Fix this entire fixture as it is into the first page of SLFRS 16. Then you can easily identify which paragraph I want to apply when I am accounting. First read the question and see what the examiner is asking, then find out the relevant paragraphs you need to apply. Clear? Entire standard I have divided into 3 categories: accounting for lessee, accounting for lessor, and sale and leaseback transactions. Right? I think I need at least 2 or 3 days to cover this, but I will take time to explain this, because this can be tested this time. Right? Let's start one by one. I will start with lessee. In lessee accounting, you can see there are major 4 points. There are major 4 points. First, we need to understand what are the major 4 points when you account him for lessee, the person who buy the asset. Number 1, application of this standard. Whether lessee can apply this standard, the transaction will be taken under this standard according to paragraph 9. even though it's taken under the paragraph 9, thereafter lessee shall think whether can whether I can apply this standard to this transaction. Therefore, lessee again think according to the paragraph 5 whether I can as the lessee account for this transaction using SLFRS 60. Is that clear? Basically, you will apply 16 paragraphs, sorry, SLFRS 16 according to the paragraph 9. Based on that, you will take into the room, SLFRS 16 room. Then assume you are the lessee, person who buy the asset. Then you need to think again, as the lessee, can I apply this or not? Is that clear? That's depend on the paragraph 5. I will explain later on, don't worry. Assume you are decided to take under this standard, then you need to initially record it at the inception of the agreement, initial recognition. Clear? Initially, you need to recognize two ledger accounts. Now, about whom we are talking about? Lessee, person who buy the asset, not the leasing company, the customer of the leasing company. Person who buy the asset, when he initially record, will recognize two accounts, the asset account and the respective liability account. The asset identified as right of use asset, not PPE, not under the PPE. The leasing asset shall recognize as right of use asset. Clear? Now you know, now you are thinking about 17. Why I am not talking about finance and operating lease? That's why I told you ignore all the memories about 17. 17 was cancelled. It's the past. Right? It's a buried dead body. Don't take again to outside. Right? No finance lease and operating lease classification in the lessee's book. Got it? This is a very important point. No finance or operating lease classification in the lessee's book. Clear? You will decide whether I will apply this standard or not according to paragraph 5. Thereafter, you initially recognize your lease with use two ledger accounts, asset account and liability account. Asset account will name as right of use asset. ROUA means right of use asset. Then asset shall be initially recognized according to paragraph 23 and 24. Let's see later on how to apply it. First, you need to know how where it is, right? Asset shall be recognized according to those paragraphs I have mentioned. Then lease liability shall be initially recognized according to paragraph 26. Once you initially recognize at the inception of the lease agreement, then you need to subsequently measure annually. Because annually, asset will depreciate or whatever method, the value will decrease according to the usage and liability will reduce according to your payment. Therefore, in the subsequent measurement, you have another two transactions. Asset reduction according to the usage, say depreciation, and the liability reduction according to the payment, installments you paid. That's the subsequent measurement. Asset shall be subsequently measured according to paragraph 29. The lease liability shall be measured according to paragraph 36 of the standard. Clear? Then, this is the very important point introduced in the standard. Reassessment and modification. What is this reassessment and modification? When you have a lease agreement as the lessee, when you pass few years from the entire period, you want to extend the period or you want to change the conditions, you will discuss with the lessor or lessor will discuss with you and both parties agree and change the conditions. What are the conditions can be changed within the period? Installment may be increase or decrease. Lease period may be increase or decrease. The right of use asset contained may be increase or decrease. For an example, you hired 3 floors of a building for your head office for 6 years. Agreed? There's a 10 stories building, first 3 floors hired by yourself. Now you are the lessee. After 2 years, you wanted to increase another floor, you want to need to take another floor. Then you will modify your, change your agreement by getting another additional floor. Then you need to increase your consideration paying, because you need to pay additional installment. And sometimes you will increase the time period also. Those are called reassessment and modification. Reassessment explained paragraph 39 and 40. Modification explained paragraph 44. Got it? These are the things you need to keep in your mind in the lessor's accounting. Right? Then let's take the lessor. Lessee's accounting, then we'll take lessor. Lessor is the person who sells the asset. Here, that all the lease classification as finance lease and operating lease exit as it is in the lessor's book. Lessor will classify lease as finance and operating lease according to paragraph 63 and 64. Thereafter, for finance lease, they need to initially measure their receivable balance, right? Because they will transfer an asset under finance lease. Therefore, they need to initially measure it. But lessor in finance lease will divide into two categories again. Lessor may be a leasing or finance institution, or lessor may be a dealer or manufacturer. For an example, I will tell you. Say, Avance or Singer showrooms, Avance showrooms, Singer showrooms, Softlogic showrooms, they are providing payment facilities to their customers, installment wise. Agreed? You can buy a laptop or any other electrical item from the Avance or Singer or Softlogic showrooms for 1 year, 2 year, 3 year installment payment process. Now, Avance or Singer or Softlogic is not a leasing company. I'm talking about that showrooms, right? Showrooms are not a leasing company, but they are doing lease, right? Those type of lessors called dealer or manufacturer. They are practicing, but unfortunately or unfortunately in Sri Lanka, all these showrooms holders started finance companies. I don't know whether it is fortunate or unfortunate in Sri Lanka, but all the showrooms holders started finance companies. Avance have Avance Finance, Singer has Singer Finance, Softlogic has their finance facilities. When they are doing their business to the finance company, there is a financial institution. Sometimes they are doing that business through the showroom. Showroom will give you the laptop to pay over 24 months. Clear? Then when the showroom doing this activity, it's called dealer or manufacturer lease. Is that clear? But when LOLC doing it, it's called a leasing through a financial institution. You have two different accounting treatment for these two transactions. Lessor, but two types of lessors you have. Understood? You have two different accounting treatment for this. When the Singer showroom doing it and when the Singer finance doing it. You can take the laptop through Singer Finance for 24 month installment. Or you can take the laptop from Singer showroom, Singer Homes for 24 month installment. Singer Finance is a financial institution. Singer Homes is a dealer or manufacturer. Clear? Separately you need to understand that. Then subsequent measurement, paragraph 75. Again, they also have that modification, because when lessee modify, that's affect to the lessor also, and the operating lease measurement and modification. Clear? And finally, sale and lease back transaction. Clear? Sale and lease back transaction is a complex area now, but don't worry, right? All accounting standards are complex. Once you understood it, it's not a complex area, right? Sale and lease back, two transactions. Sale and lease back. Sale generally will be identified under SLFRS 15, contract with customer. Got it? Lease back is under SLFRS 16, leasing. Therefore, before account for it, you need to see whether sale is satisfying the requirement of SLFRS 15 or not. Got it? Before account for sale and leaseback transaction, you need to see whether sales transaction, sales, not the leaseback, sales transaction is satisfying SLFRS 15 requirement or not. What is the SLFRS 15 requirement? Satisfying performance obligation. If entity satisfying those requirement, it will be account according to SLFRS 15 and leaseback will taken under SLFRS 60. That's why I have mentioned sale under SLFRS 15. Then you have to learn 3 points. You will sell it at fair value, or you will sell it at less than fair value, or you will sell at the asset more than fair value. Through three situations you need to understand. If that sale transaction not satisfying SLFRS 15, you have to apply a paragraph 103. Now, I know you are wondering, what is this application of SLFRS 15? I will tell you a simple example. I am a businessman, right? I need money. I don't have option. Bank not providing OD. I can't take short term facilities. Only option I have, I can sell my building to you and take it back under lease agreement. That's called sale and lease back. Then I can have both asset and the money. Clear? Say you have a motor vehicle, you want to manage, you want to take your wedding, but you don't have cash. Then what you can do? You can sell the vehicle to the leasing company and take back again under lease with the loan. Got it? This is the sale and lease back. Right? Now you can understand this easily. Now there are so many advertisements. Within 3 minutes, we will give you money for your book of the three wheeler. Three wheel leke potra davas tuning salli, pay tuning salli. Home again, only those are sale and lease back. Three wheel leke menna salli yara yan. These are the advertisement we are hearing this. Three wheel leke ngawa, winar tuning salli gata, three wheel leke magia. Hey, man, again. Sale and lease back transactions. Then what is the application of SLFRS 15 and not application of SLFRS 15? According to SLFRS 15, if you sell an asset, clear? The control of the asset should be transferred to the buyer. According to paragraph 31 of SLFRS 15, clearly mentioned, sales will complete, performance obligation will satisfy when you transfer the control to the buyer. That means buyer can prevent others using the asset. That's the transferring control. If I sell this to you, right, you only can use this, others cannot use. That means you are get the control, you got the control, otherwise not getting the control. Clear? If so, that means if when you are selling your motor vehicle to the leasing company, if leasing company getting the control, right, it's a sale. If leasing company not getting the control, if it's not a sale, if it is a sale, you will apply sale under SLFRS 15, those paragraph 100 and other one, please correct this. This should be 101, right? I will correct it, then you can actually correct. This should be 101. If that sales transaction satisfying SLFRS 15, 100 and 101 is the relevant paragraphs to apply. But if leasing company not getting the control of the asset we sold, you cannot apply 101 or 100, you have to go for the 103. If leasing company not getting the control means it not satisfying SLFRS 15, is that clear? Then it's just a loan you taken. If it is not satisfying SLFRS 15 means you have not sold the asset actually to the lessor, you have taken a loan only, because there is the lease back. Then it's a financial liability under SLFRS 9. Very simple. Therefore, those who are going to apply 16 must apply 9 and 15, all three together. Exactly. This is the summary of this standard. Now we are going to learn section by section. Is that clear? Section by section we will learn now. Right. Let's start with LACI. Accounting for LACI. You know what you need to learn now. Okay? Right. In LACI, these are the main area we need to learn. Initial measurement, subsequent measurement of the asset, subsequent measurement of the liability, final payments that guarantees residual value, and lease payment in advance, lease payment in arrears, and the modification. Those are the areas you need to learn. Now we are going to start to learn accounting for LACI. Got it? Ignore all the memories of LESO and sale and lease back, we will take later on. Today we are going to start now accounting for LACI, person who buy the asset. Right? Let's start with this simple example. Right? But through this simple example, I will explain everything. Okay. Right. But before that, I told you one mistake. LACI shall decide whether I will apply this standard or not. I told you paragraph 5. Let's see what is it before moving to the accounting part. Paragraph 5. Recognition exemptions. Right? See paragraph 5. A LACI may elect not to apply this standard. Is that clear? LACI may select not to apply this standard if lease period is very short. That is less than 1 year. Practically it is less than 1 year. If the lease period less than 1 year and the value of the identified asset is very low, LACI can decide not to apply this standard. Is that clear? Now, I told you generally, first you must think there is a transaction, right? You and the lessor has a transaction. First, you must apply paragraph 9, whether I can apply this standard or not for this transaction. To see that, to apply that, there should be an identified asset. You should have control over the use and there is a payment process. Clear? Now, it is satisfied. Therefore, you decided to apply 16. Thereafter, again as the lessee, you can think whether I apply or not based on these two conditions. If the lease term less than 1 year, very short, and the identified asset has a very low value, is that clear? You can decide not to apply this standard. Clear? Now you know throughout these days we will learn this standard. If you decided not to apply this standard by the lessee, what the option they have? It is explained in paragraph 6. If the lessee elect not to apply the requirement of this standard to either short term lease or lease for which underlying asset is of low value, the lessee shall recognize lease payment associated with those leases as an expense on either straight line basis or lease term or another systematic basis. Is that clear? Right. Look here. There is a transaction between two parties, right? See whether can apply SLFRS 16. If it is yes, or no, say no, then you shall apply another standard as applicable, right? If transaction come under the SLF, that paragraph 9, right? According to paragraph 9, if you can apply SLFRS 16, then as LACI, need to see,
can apply SLFRS 16 again. Is it clear? That is paragraph 5. If it is not short term, if it is not low value asset, you will apply. Agreed? If it is not short term, if it is not low value asset, you will apply this. Otherwise, you are not applying. If answer is like here, if answer is, you will apply paragraph 22 to, right? If no, recognize lease payment as an expense. Very simple. Is it clear? That is explained in paragraph 6. This is the process that lessee should be applied. First, you will take under the standard, under paragraph 9. Thereafter, according to paragraph 5, you have to see whether it is a short term lease and low value lease. If it is short term lease, low value lease, you decide that not to apply this standard. If so, recognize that payment as an expense in the P&L. The way you have to apply over the straight line method or any other systematic method, you can apply according to paragraph 6. If it is not a low value or not a short term, it's a long term lease, more than 1 year, it's a high value lease, you will apply this standard from paragraph 22 to above. Is it clear? This is the lessor's pathway. Is it clear? This is very important. Keep your mind. I will take an example to explain that point also. Then we can complete section by section with examples. There was a question in ACCA paper. If you have a chance, please search and read that question. One company purchased 10 laptops, right, to pay within 10 months, one laptop worth less than 100,000 rupees, right? Say in rupees, 100,000 rupees. Now, 10 laptops to pay within 10 months. Clear? Now, see that is short term and very low. If you take a single laptop, value very low, less than 100,000. Period also less than 1 year. Therefore, you can decide not to apply this standard and recognize those payment as an expense. But the problem is you have taken 10 laptops. If you take the aggregated value, it will be a significant value to the company. Therefore, that time you have to take all the laptops together and value as a significant value. Is that clear? But if you take a single laptop to pay within 10 months, you can charge those things into the expenses. But think the materiality of the asset and the value. Clear? That type of question can be tested to see whether you have understanding of the paragraph 5 or not. Is that clear? Right. Let's move into the question again. Is this clear? If it is short term, less low value, you will charge payments into P&L as an expense over a straight line or in a systematic way. If it is long term, high value asset, you will apply SLFRS 16, that is paragraph 22 to 49. Clear? Right. Why they have mentioned paragraph 22 to 49? Here, you can see from paragraph 22 to 49 will cover accounting for lessee. According to paragraph 5, you will decide whether you can apply this standard or not. Thereafter, right, if you decide to apply this standard, you have to apply from 22 to 49. I have highlighted the major paragraph within that. Okay. Now we are going to learn how lessee account according to SLFRS 16. Is that clear? Now we are in here, right? We are not talking about this or this, we are in here. That means we are going to learn from paragraph 22 to 49. I will take the example. This is the example. I will cover initial recognition, subsequent measurement, everything from this question. Clear? Let's read the example. XPLC entered into lease. The following information is relevant. XPLC must pay 5 annual rentals of 100,000 in arrears. At the year end, each year end, you will pay 100,000 over 5 years. Got it? Okay. Please note down. Thereafter, I will take entire the camera to the whiteboard. Therefore, please highlight all the information. 5 annual installments, 100,000 per annum. XPLC must also guarantee the residual value of the asset at the end of the lease term of 40,000. That means, in addition to 5 installment, lessee will pay additional 40,000 at the end of the period, that is the 5th year. Therefore, first year 100,000, second year 100,000, third year 100,000, fourth year 100,000 you will pay, 5th year you will pay 140,000. You have agreed to pay additional 40,000 through the asset or by cash. That is the guaranteed residual value at the end of the lease period, 40,000. The initial direct cost, simply say transaction cost of the lease agreement. Initial direct cost, 5,000. Implicit rate, implicit interest rate of the lease agreement, that is the effective interest rate within the lease agreement, implicit rate, 8%. These are the information. Ready? Right. Now we are going to learn initial recognition. Got it? This is the same example. This is the same example. We are going to learn initial recognition for this. Now, initial recognition, I think you have summarized or you've seen what are the paragraphs you need to apply. Initial recognition according to paragraph 23, 24 is the asset, 26 is the liability. Right? In the very first time, you can apply this by reading it. Let's see how to apply. Right? The standard paragraph 22. Recognition. This talk about lessee, right? Recognition. At the commencement date, a lessee shall recognize a right of use asset and lease liability, two ledger accounts. Clear? I think you can remember what I told you few minutes ago. Right of use asset and lease liability. These are two ledger accounts you need to recognize. How to recognize right of use asset? Paragraph 23 and 24 as I told you. Here, how to recognize right of use asset? Paragraph 23 and 24. That's why I told you to take this picture into the first page of the standard. Let's see. Paragraph 23. At the commencement date, a lessee shall measure the right of use asset at cost. Asset will be measured at cost. Clear? Right. Then we are talking about the right of use asset. It shall be measured at cost. What are the components of cost? Component of cost explained in paragraph 24. 4 items you have as the cost. I will explain using this example. Therefore, I will take that Excel sheets to explain. Then no need to use the board. Let's take Excel sheet. Right, now we are going to identify the right of use. As said, we need to have a ledger account, right? This is right of use asset. Right. The cost of the asset include four things according to paragraph 24. If you have the standard, please use the standard book, right? Right. Let's see what are the four items of the cost. Clear? Right. The amount of the initial measurement of the lease liability as described paragraph 20. Six. The amount of the initial measurement of the lease liability. Now, I have told you in my presentation, lease liability shall be measured according to paragraph 26. Therefore, cost of the asset will be the liability value. Let's see what is the liability value. Paragraph 26 is the liability value. Therefore, when you recording the first part of the cost, automatically you will recognize lease liability account tools. Got it? Therefore, better to rule a lease liability account in addition to this. This is lease liability. Therefore, you need to use two accounts. How to measure the lease liability? Very simple. Present value of lease payments. Here, at the commencement date, lessee shall measure the lease liability at the present value of lease payment that are not paid at the date. Not paid at the date. At the year 0, today, installment not paid. Is that clear? Why? Down payment is not come here. Lease liability will be the amount to be paid and at their present value. Any down payment not taken here, very important, not paid at the date. At the time you agreed to the lease, you have future installment. Take present value of those future installment, because liability consider include only the present value of installment to be paid. Down payment is not a payment to be paid, it already paid. When you buy a vehicle, 5 million, say you pay 2 million in cash today, therefore lease liability will be the balance payable at their present value. 2 million is a down payment, it's not a part of the lease payment. Is that clear? Right. Therefore, you need to take the present value of the payments. Is that clear? Right. What are the payments you have here in your example? What are the payments you have here? 100,000 over 5 years and 40,000 at the end of the 5th year. That's all. How you discount? Using implicit interest rate. If you cannot find out implicit interest rate, here they clearly mention interest rate implicit in the lease agreement. It was given 8%. If it is not available, use incremental borrowing rate. First use implicit interest rate. If it is not available, use lessee's incremental borrowing rate. First entry is the present value of the payments, right? According to the question, you agreed to pay 5 installments over 5 years. Over 5 years, you will pay 100,000. Over 5 years, but in the 5th year, you will pay 140,000. Clear? You need to discount these cash flows by 8%. I'm not going to talk about how to discount those everything. You know how to discount it. Discount 100,000 by 5 years accumulated discounting factor. Discount 40,000 by 5th year discounting factor. It is very simple, right? That value will debit right of use asset, credit liability. Got it? How to discount? I will show the calculation. Here is the calculation. 1 to 5 year, 100,000 will be discounted by 5 year accumulated discounting factor. Clear? At the 5th year, you will agree to pay. You have agreed to pay guarantee that residual value 40,000 at the 5th year discounting factor. Once you discount all the amount to be paid to lessor, that value will be 426,494. Is that clear? This is according to the paragraph 24A. The amount of the initial measurement of the liability is a part of the cost of the right of use asset. Therefore, you will debit here 426,494 liability credit, the same value. Clear? Here you can write down lease liability, here you can write down right of use asset. Just write down here lease liability, here write down right of use, that's it. 24A, part of the cost. In addition to that, you know the asset value consists 4 points, paragraph 24A, clear? This is 24A, then you have 24B, then you have 24C, then you have 24D. Because paragraph 24 consists cost consists right of use asset 4 items. Clear? I will explain one by one, then you can read this standard clearly. The B talk about down payment. Clear? That's why they ask you to not to take down payment as the part of the liability. Down payment is the cash you given to the supplier, right? Therefore, 24B talk about down payment. Clear? In your example, tell me, is there any down payment? No. Zero. 24C talk about simply I am telling the different technical words there, initial cost, initial incurred cost, simply transaction cost as the financial asset. Remember, transaction cost. Do you have transaction cost there? Yes, 5,000 you incurred. Where it credit? Is the amount you paid in cash. Cash book will credit. Transaction cost will credit. Cash, because you paid 5,000 in cash for legal fees, stamp duties, processing fees, everything you paid in cash. Cash book credit, the asset debit. Okay? And number 4, which was explained in paragraph 16 of SLFRS 16, when you have an asset, you may have bound to dismantle the asset at the end of the period. Any estimated dismantling and removing cost is a provision, right? It's a provision. After 5 years, you may have to dismantle the asset. The estimated cost at the end of the 5th year shall be provided today as part of the cost of the asset. Provision for dismantle cost. Is that clear? Here, no amount estimated. Therefore, your initial cost of right of use asset will be 531,494. Your initial value of the liability according to paragraph 26 is 526,494. Oh, that's all. That's the initial recognition. Asset consists four value: lease liability, asset debit liability credit, down payment, asset debit cash credit, transaction cost, asset debit cash credit, dismantle cost, asset debit provision credit. Asset consists four items, liability consists only one item. When you identify the asset, according to paragraph 24, automatically you will identify the financial, lease liability. That's all about initial recognition. Is that clear? Our examples also provided those double entries here. Right of use asset debit, lease liability credit. Right of use asset debit 5,000, cash credit, that is a transaction cost. In this example, we have only two items of the cost. Clear? No down payment, no provision for dismantle cost. That's all. Is that clear? That is the initial recognition. Now, our next duty is subsequent measurement. Got it? Right. Subsequent measurement, explain here. Subsequent measurement from paragraph 29. In my presentation, I told you right of use asset paragraph 29, liability paragraph 36. Because now you already opened two ledger accounts in your ledger, right of use asset and liability. Now you need to subsequently measure both ledger accounts. Clear? How to measure the asset subsequently at the end of the 1st year? Paragraph 29. How to measure lease liability? Paragraph 36. Let's see how to measure asset at the 1st year end. After the commencement date, that is after this recognition, I am talking about the asset. After the recognition, what you need to do? A lessee shall measure the right of use asset applying cost model, unless it applies either of the measurement models described in 34 or 35. That means they have more than one measurement model. Cost model or any other model. Cost model means cost minus depreciation minus impairment losses plus or minus any modifications. Additional point you have here. In the cost model take cost minus accumulated depreciation and accumulated impairment as PPE. In addition to that, you need to adjust any reassessments. Clear? I told you this agreement can be changed during the period. Any changes will adjust to the asset and the liability. Therefore, asset subsequently measure cost minus accumulated depreciation, accumulated impairment losses, any reassessments. If you use the cost model, clear? If you are not using the cost model, other measurement model, if it is an investment property, you can go for fair value model. Remember, you taken as the lessee that asset, you sublease again to another party, you are the intermediary, then you sublease it to other party will be an investment property for you. For the investment property, you can apply fair value model. Clear? Therefore, no need to go for the cost model. Is that clear? But basically, we will apply depreciation model, cost model. Here, they didn't mention they are applying separate model. Therefore, we can apply cost model. Therefore, we need to apply for the 1st year P&L. What we need to apply? Depreciation. depreciation, how you will calculate the depreciation? Cost 431,494, agreed? The sum of both value minus residual value 40,000, agreed? Residual value 40,000, then divided by divided by 5 years. That's how you need to calculate depreciation. Clear? Divided by 5 years. Lease period 5 years, you will depreciate over 5 years basically. You have some exemptions of depreciation period. Basically, you will depreciate over 5 years. What is the value? Depreciation value will be 431,494 minus 40,000 all together divide by 5. This is the depreciation. P&L debit here, credit. No information about impairment, no information about any reassessment. Clear? Therefore, this is the first year end value of the asset. You can close your asset here. Let's close the asset account for the year end. This will be the carried down value. And this will be the brought forward value. That is the end of the asset account. Okay? But this calculation of depreciation, this part, is very crucial. Calculation of depreciation is crucial. Therefore, I will explain about that. Clear? Take this standard. How to calculate depreciation? See this paragraph. Paragraph 32. How to calculate depreciation? Paragraph 32, okay? If the lease transfer ownership of the underlying asset to lessee after 5 years, asset may be legally transferred to the lessee, person who using now, by the end of the lease term, or if the cost of the right of use asset reflect that the lease will exercise a purchase option, the lessee shall depreciate the right of use asset from the commencement date to the end of the useful life of the underlying asset. If you have an idea, you will get the ownership of asset, depreciate it over not the 5 years, over the useful life of the asset. Because if you believe you can use more than 5 years after the payments, depreciate asset over the useful life. If you are doubt, you are not getting the ownership. If you want to transfer after the 5th year, if you want to transfer the asset to the lessor after 5th year, depreciate lower of lease period or useful life. Is that clear? If you are in doubt whether I receive the asset end of the lease period or not, you don't know, depreciate over lower of lease period or useful life. Lower of lease period or useful life. If you are confident that you will receive the asset, depreciate over the useful life. Paragraph 32, how to depreciate. Clear? Right. Here we assume asset also have 5 years, lease period also have 5 years. Therefore, we have depreciated at over the 5 years after reducing the residual value, because that is the guaranteed residual value by the Let's see. Now asset account is over. Clear? Now we need to learn how to subsequently measure the lease liability. Very simple. This is just like amortized cost financial liability. What you need to do? Recognize finance cost using the effective interest rate on opening balance, reduce any cash payment. Got it? Now, recognize finance cost on the opening balance as financial liability amortized cost. Therefore, it goes to P&L interest cost. Right? It goes to P&L interest cost. How? Using effective interest rate, implicit rate, the rate you discount the cash flows on the opening balance. That is, you need to calculate interest 426,494 into, is that 8%? 8%. Very simple. Therefore, interest will be this into 0.808. Debit profit and loss. This is just like amortized cost financial liability, very simple, right? This standard simplified the accounting process. Any cash payment shall reduce. Got it? Any cash payment shall reduce means at the end of the first year, you will pay your first installment 100,000. That's your first installment, right? Cash book credit. You have paid 100,000. Clear? This can be exercised over the 5 years. Is it zero? No. It will be ended with 40,000. Asset also ended with 40,000 residual value. This will be ended with 40,000 guaranteed residual value. If you want to pay cash, you can pay and take the asset, or you can transfer asset at the 40,000. Clear? Okay, let's take the balance of the account. This is again very important because you need to show the balance sheet extract at the end of the first year. This is your net lease liability at the end of the first year, carried down value. Your brought forward value also same. This is the lease liability you need to present in your balance sheet. Clear? This is the lease liability you need to present in your balance sheet. Right. If you continue up to the 5th year, at the 5th year, this will be ended with 40,000 balance. That is the guaranteed residual value to be paid. Asset also ended with 40,000, that is the residual value of the asset. Clear? You can practice at your home. Right. Now, I think we have discussed both initial measurement and subsequent measurement of lessee's book for the lease taken by a lessee. Right? Okay. This is just like an amortized cost financial liability. Is that clear? Very simple. Now, our next duty is to identify financial statement extracts at the end of the first year. Let's take the balance sheet first. Financial statement extracts. Assume this is statement of financial position. Right? Here rupees. Value. You have non-current asset at the balance sheet. Under that, under the non-current asset, you will recognize right of use asset. Got it? The value of the right of use asset will be the value you recognize as the balance of the asset. Clear? That is non-current asset. Then you need to recognize lease liability. Lease liability shall be recognized both non-current liability and, you know, both non-current liability and current liability. Is that clear? Lease liability. Again, you need to recognize this. Current liability, that is short term portion of lease liability, you know that, right? Short term portion of lease liability, I will just write down lease liability, short term portion of lease liability. This is the most important part. This is the lease liability, this is my lease account, right? Lease liability account. This is the lease liability I shall recognize in the balance sheet, clear? But this is the total. I need to pay, right? Look here. I need to pay 100,000 installment in next year. Next year installment is the current portion. But it is including the interest of next year. Next year interest will be 8% on the open balance. Clear? Therefore, I can say like this. Just calculate as a working interest for this year. This equal this into 8%. Clear? That is 28,000 for next year PNL. Next year PNL. I am working for next year, right? To identify the next year interest, then here simply you can say this minus 28,849. Clear? Interest portion will be reduced. Therefore, your current portion will be 100,000 minus this interest. If this is the current portion, am I correct? If this is the current portion, non-current portion will be total liability minus this. The sum of these two will be 360,614. That is the total lease liability. That's how you have to present. No need to do more calculation, right? The current portion is the next year installment, but you have the interest portion there, eliminate it. Very simply, based on the open balance at the end of the first year, you can calculate the next year interest. Then from the next year installment, eliminate next year interest, balance is the current portion, rest is the non-current portion. Clear? That's all for the balance sheet extracts for the lease. Asset recognized, liability also recognized. PNL, next, PNL. Profit and loss. Extracts. Statement of profit and loss. Right? You have only 2 points. One. Depreciation cost, other one finance cost, interest cost, let's say interest cost. You have an as expense, depreciation you calculated this much, finance cost you calculated, first year finance cost this much. Clear? That's the PNL extracts. Then we need to take statement of cash flow extracts. Statement of cash flow. You have have only one cash flow, right? 100,000 payment and 5,000 payment transaction cost. Transaction cost paid for the acquisition of an asset. You have capitalized. It is an investment activity. Then you need to identify the finance activities also. Under the investment activity, right? You have acquisition of assets. You paid 5,000 in cash, right? Then you paid 100,000 to settle the liability. Repayment of lease creditor, liability. If you want, finance cost can be present under the after the operating activities, or you can present here, because interest cost is a finance activity. But according to the LK 7 cash flow statement, if you want, you can present finance cost before the investment activities, but after the operating activities. Let's mention here, it's not wrong, right? Interest paid. Interest paid is the first year interest. Repayment of liability means 100,000 minus interest. This is a cash outflow. The total is the repayment, but repayment of lease liability 65,000, interest paid 34,120. This is the transaction cost paid as an investment activity. Cash flow, P&L and balance sheet. Got it? Right. Now, if I take my presentation again, I have told you how to apply paragraph 5, clear? How to apply initial measurement of right of use asset, and how to apply initial measurement of lease liability, how to apply subsequent measurement of asset and the lease liability. Up to this point, I completed. No need to do many questions. Even you do 100,000 questions, you will do the same. Why we need to do more questions? That was a general practice of chartered accountants students. Why? We are doing many questions, you know why? We are not focusing this standard, right? Now, standard said the initial measurement, the asset value would be these four items in the paragraph 24. We are not seeing this paragraph. To take this practice into your body, you do many questions. When you do 100,000 or 1,000 or 100 questions, you will automatically take the technique into your body. But if you understand this paragraph, no need to do at least one question. Clear? Therefore, just do one question clearly with the application guidelines. Then, even you receive 1,000 questions thereafter, you know what you have to do. Clear? Then, to know what you have to do, you need to take this into your first page. Then, you know what you have to do. Clear? One thing. I told you the depreciation shall be calculated according to paragraph 32. Remember, this mention just initially can be measured at cost or any other method, right? Depreciation, I told you, additional paragraph shall be calculated according to paragraph 32. If you want, you can add here. Clear? How to calculate depreciation, paragraph 32. Clear? Therefore, at the exam, don't do anything without referring to the paragraph. I am not asking you to write down the paragraph. At least just read it. then you have an idea. Clear? Don't touch everything in the with the dark. Just read and apply. Okay. We have completed up to third point. Now we need to learn what is reassessment and what is modification. Ready? Right. We completed subsequent measurement. This is, remember, subsequent measurement of liability we did. What we did? Subsequent measurement of liability. This is subsequent measurement of liability. What we did? Taken the opening balance, multiplied by effective interest rate, implicit rate, recognize the finance cost, whatever the amount paid, reduce, just like amortized cost financial liability. In my presentation, I told you that is paragraph 36. Just see what is paragraph 36 says. After the commencement date, lessee shall measure lease liability by increasing the carrying amount to reflect the interest on the lease liability. You increase the carrying amount to reflect the lease liability with the interest. You increase to 460,000. Then you need to reduce the lease liability by amount you paid, payment made. Clear? What is the payment made? You reduce it by 100,000. In addition to that, only one thing you can take, that is the reassessment of the lease liability. This told in the asset also. When there is a reassessment, you will take asset and the liability. Now we are going to learn how to reassess. Clear? The reassessment and the modification. Here lease modification, here reassessment. Got it? That's the final point for lessee. First thing you need to learn, what is a modification, what is a reassessment. I am not going to read these paragraphs. I will explain. Thereafter, read it. You can easily understand. Reassessment means changing existing term of the contract. Got it? Changing existing term of the contract. Modification means introducing new term to the contract. I think you got the understanding. Is that clear? Reassessment means you will change the existing terms of the lease contract. What are the existing terms? Lease period, installment, interest rate, or other conditions stipulated in the lease agreement will change. That's called reassessment, because value will change. When you change installment, when you change the interest rate, when you change the period stipulated in the period in the agreement, your present value of the liability will change. Am I correct? If present value of the liability change, asset also change, because present value of the liability passed through the asset. Therefore, any change in the existing term, the existing asset account and the existing liability carrying value will change. Got it? Therefore, how to account for reassessment? By changing the existing right of use asset and liability. Clear? Simply keep your mind, reassessment means changing existing terms. Shall read 39. After the commencement date, a lessee shall apply paragraph 40 to 43 to remeasure the lease liability to reflect change to the lease payment. A lessee shall recognize the amount of remeasurement of lease liability as an adjustment to right of use asset. That means double entry will pass through right of use asset and the lease liability. Very simple. Clear? Right. How? Lessee shall remeasure the lease liability by discounting the revised lease payment. Clear? Revised lease payment, discount it again. Let's take an example now. Very nice example. The same story. This same story, same question, right? I will add only one change. Let's take Let us see this example, remeasuring, the reassessment. You can see you have the original information, XPLC entered into 5-year loan, so release, the lease liability 426,494 as we measured. Remember, we are talking about the original contract. Company incurred initial cost 5,000, remember the same story. XPLC recognized right of use asset equal to 431,494, remember the original example. XPLC has guaranteed 40,000 residual value. The same question, they have extract the summary, further information. XPLC has an options to extend, has an option within the original contract, has an options to extend the lease period for further 3 years, but for additional 3 years, installment will be 110,000, clear, 110,000. Got it? XPLC would not have to guarantee residual value if it is extended. If they extend for another 3-year period, no need to pay guaranteed residual value. Got it? That's the story. Now here mention, XPLC circumstances have changed. If it's now originally, XPLC would not have to guarantee the residual value if it is were exercise the options to extend the lease term. The second paragraph, at the commencement date, original date, XPLC concluded that it was not reasonably certain to exercise the option. At the first day, you do not know whether you will exercise or not. Therefore, what you are going to do? You will take 100,000 for installment, 40,000 last installment, discount and recognize 426,494 as the finance lease liability. Clear? Not finance liability, lease liability. Because you are not sure, whether you extend or not. But what happened thereafter? XP after end of the 4th year. Now you followed until the 4th year with the original contract, because you are not sure at the beginning whether you extend or not. But when you comes at the 4th year end, what was happened? See, XPLC circumstances have changed and it's now reasonably certain that it will exercise the option to extend for 3 years at a price of 110,000 per annum. If so, your incremental borrowing rate will be 9%. Standard say you can use incremental borrowing rate. Okay? You can use the incremental borrowing rate. Now, if you extend, additional installment will be 110,000, the rate will be 9%. This is going to be done after 4 years. Therefore, what you need to do? You need to continue this lease liability account and asset account until the end of 4th year. Clear? Because at the end of the 4th year, you are going to reassess. Not now. Therefore, these two accounts need to be continued until 4th year end. Is that clear? Let's continue. Take separate. I will take into the other page. 1st year. This is right of use asset. Let's continue until the end of 4th year. Hurry up quickly. Because to learn this clearly, you need to continue. Then second year depreciation, same straight line basis. same depreciation 78,299, right? Then you can conclude the account for the second year after depreciation. I am talking about the asset account. Right, see. Now at the end of the second year, right. Now I have prepared the asset account up to the beginning of fourth year, right? Because this change is going to be happen within the fourth year. Therefore, I have not finalized fourth year. I have finalized up to the fourth year beginning. Therefore, carrying value at the beginning of fourth year 196,598. Okay. Right. Now you can charge depreciation for the fourth year, no problem, because that assessment going to be happen at the end of the fourth year. Therefore, you can charge depreciation also for the fourth year, but don't finalize that liability going to be changed. Clear? Once you depreciate over 3 years, you have open imbalance 196,598. You can charge fourth year depreciation also. That is a at the big within the fourth year. This is the situation. Let's take liability also like this, right? Liability account. Now you need to continue liability account at the beginning of fourth year. Let's do here. Liability account, the value was 100,000. Now this was the end of first year situation, correct? End of first year situation is this. Okay. Now let's continue for the up to that this level. Let's take and third year again for end of fourth year. You paid 100,000 in cash. The second installment, therefore, your balance will be this. open imbalance this, correct? Then you will take interest for the third year. Interest will be this into 8%. Is that correct? You paid 100,000 in cash. Therefore, third year balance will be 100,000. This is the opening balance of the fourth year, correct? This is the situation. Now, fourth year interest also you will take this into 0.8 to PNL. And you pay cash at the fourth year, but you are not going to finalize both account, right? These are the two situation. Right? Asset, you open imbalance, you charge depreciation. Liability, you recognize finance cost and the cash payment. At the end of the fourth year, now you are at the end of the fourth year, your process is going to be changed. Is that clear? At the end of fourth year, I will explain on the board, Suraj. Originally, you agreed to pay over 5 years. 100,000, I am taking by 1,000 figures, and 40. Got it? When you reach fourth year end, you decided to change this agreement by adding another 3 years. When you reach this day, now you are here, right? You decided to extend the period by adding 110 installment. According to the question, see back to the video and see. Go back to the video and see. You decided not to residual value. Remember. Now this is the new story. Is that clear? Now see paragraph 26. What is the lease liability? Paragraph 26, what is the lease liability? Present value of the amount to be paid at the date. What is at the date? End of the, this is at the date now. This is at the date, present value of the payments. Now present value of the payment means the present value of these payments. But the incremental interest rate is 9%. That should be the new lease liability. According to paragraph 26, lease liability is the present value of payment to be paid at the date. Now, end of the fourth year, at the date now, what are the payments to be paid? 100,000 end of the next year, then 110,000 another for 3 years. Then their present value at the new rate is the new lease liability. Just discount at 9% and see what is the value. I think you can see the calculation. Fifth year end, you have to pay 100,000, as I told you. Then the sixth year end, seventh year end, eighth year end, other 3 years, you have to pay 110,000. You are discounting factor at 9%, but incremental borrowing rate. Once you discount, your new liability will be 347,195. Got it? very simple. The assessment, this is not a highly magical technical points. Very simple. Paragraph 26. The present value of the installment to be paid at the date. Now you add the fourth year end. See what are the payments you need to be paid. Another 100,000 to be paid according to the original contract, and additional another 110,000 for another 3 years. Rate was changed to 9% from 8%. Therefore, discount the installment to be paid with the 9%. Therefore, liability would be 347,195. Clear? What we need to do is, this would be the, what? The closing balance at the end of the fourth year. Because this is the liability now. Let's see the our ledger account. This is the liability account. Right? You have recognized fourth year opening balance, finance cost for the fourth year, payment for the fourth year. Clear? But closing balance will be this, 347,195. This would be the closing balance. Got it? This is the carried down value. This is the fifth year brought forward balance. If this is so, you will have a difference within this account. Let's see what is the difference. You will have a difference here. In this box, you will have a difference. 217,566. You will have a difference. I will show you. Here also they have identified 217,565. Is that clear? Just 1 rupee change. This is the difference arise due to the remeasurement of the liability. You have not take balance the account, you have taken from outside the balance. How? You discounted future payments at the end of the fourth. Therefore, this would be the new liability balance. Clear? This would be the new liability balance. Therefore, in the liability account, you take it as the liability. Is that clear? If so, you will have a difference like this. This is the difference you need to consider. Once you balance the account, you have a difference. This difference will pass through according to the paragraph, pass through what? Remember, there is a change in the lease term, lessee shall recognize the amount of remeasurement of lease liability as adjustment to the right of use asset. Therefore, the change credit right lease liability debit right of use asset. Therefore, you need to debit this change into the right of use asset. Here, saying lease liability. Right of use asset debit, lease liability credit. Got it? Now, you will have new balance for the asset, new carrying value. This is the new carrying value, carried down value, brought forward value. Okay. Since you have passed the liability change as liability credit, asset debit, okay, as liability credit, asset debit, you will have a new asset value and you will have new liability value. Now let's see how we can account for the fifth year. This is fifth year now. Got it? You need to calculate your depreciation to the PNL. I'm not going to show, I will show you. Your new carrying value 335,865. Got it? Do you have any agreed residual value? No. Therefore, divide it by remaining useful life. IFRS 16 also using same. Remaining useful life, 4 years. You are at the beginning of the first year, fifth year, fifth, sixth, seventh and eighth. It increased from 5 to 8. Now you are at the fifth year. Their remaining useful life will be divided by 4. Depreciation will be 83,966. Now you can continue, I know. Clear? Liability, how you can recognize the liability? Very simple. Interest cost goes to profit and loss. How? Opening balance 347,195 into new rate 9%. Got it? This into 9%. Your payment, fifth year payment, how much? Cash? 110,000, no, 100,000. Still it is 100,000 in the fifth year. Sixth year onward, it will be 110,000. Therefore, this payment only 100,000. Like continue up to the end of 8 years. That's about reassessment. Clear? Only one thing we need to discuss further in respect of lessee, that is modification. But we don't have time. Let's continue tomorrow. Right? Thank you very much.